It is going to be a very, very great honor to introduce our next guest. Because when I first started waking up what was going on in the world, this man and his definite straight talk was one of the things that woke me up. And he talked about a lot of subjects, but the one that really blew me away about him, he's the only one that talks about how society has slipped away from that pinnacle of integrity and class. How many people in this room remember when the words "Made in America" was like gold? They were some of the most powerful words in the world. Okay? America, it was industry that made this country, and you had people, they came in, they started building things, they built them with pride. Pride was one of the greatest gifts this country gave. Because people, they could come in no matter where they came from, here they got a chance to make themselves more than what they were, what their parents were, what everyone from their previous generations were. That's what this country was. That's the greatest gift that's given to the world. That path for every man and woman to become more. And this guy made me realize that that has slipped away, but it can come back. It has to come back. It'll save this country more than anything. And right now, I want to introduce that man, ladies and gentlemen, the trends forecaster himself, Sir Gerald Celente.
Speakers and just listen to that last presentation. And this is what's going to change things, is when more of this happens and more people find it within themselves to really do what needs to be done. So thank you for putting on this wonderful event. And the reason I'm here tonight is Anthony Friedman, and the great illustrator, does work for us in our Trends Journal magazine. And I saw that he was going to be involved in this, so I called Anthony up. I said, listen, I'd like to do what I can do, too, to join in and help this movement. And so they asked me to talk about a couple of things and the topics we looked at. And when you look at America, and you talk about quality and what it used to be, you look at that Detroit going into dust, and you look at those grand buildings that they have. And now what do? They build big box stores. Oh, it's lovely. It's like going into a large self-storage unit. Yeah. And then they used to have these things when I was a kid at pharmacists.
There we go.
I remember Mr. Robbins, a social client from the Bronx, the Yonkers. There was a little pharmacy. And it was a great little place. Now you go into Walgreens or CVS. And there were dress shops and haberdashers. And there were hardware stores. Now there's, hey, there's Home Depot. What a beautiful place. Hey, how about Lowe's? And they had stationery stores. No more. No, no. So all we have now is Staples. Perfect. And what else? Office Depot. No more stationery stores. And you keep going up and down the list. It's a takeover. This is not globalization. It's multinational. There was no such thing as hedge funds when I was growing up. They own everything, private equity groups. So what happened to America? The fish rots from the head down, as they say. What happened to this beautiful country? Look at the fish at the top. Now we can go up and down the list. Hey, try this one off for size. Read my lips, no new taxes. I didn't have sex with that woman model who used to. I smoked, but I didn't inhale. Right away, that should have been the end of that one. What are you doing with this stuff, you know? Saddam Hussein has weapons of mass destruction and ties to Al-Qaeda. could do away with that Patriot Act. I'm going to close Guantanamo. Yeah. Hey, and that you re-elect me, and I'm going to end that war in Afghanistan in 2014. Or maybe 2024. I didn't carry the one. Slick Willie, Little Boy Bush, B.S. Obama, one clown after another. You look at Congress, a cavalcade of clowns. Look at these people. Pelosi, oh yeah, man, she got it together. Hey, how about Boner? Oh no, Bonner. No, Boner. Yeah. And Diane, not your fine stud. You go out, Harry Reid. You know Harry Reid? Any person that looks up to a politician is looking down upon themselves. You want to know what happens in a country? The country's been sold out by lightweights. Hey, you need a lightweight? How about that heavyweight Christie? What a show that is, man. Oh yeah, we should put that one on every night. And it tells a story, by the way, just so you know, a little background here. At a graduate school, I used to run political campaigns in Westchester County. And then they sent me up to Albany, and I was the assistant to the secretary of the New York State Senate. Worst job I ever had. I'm a young guy, you know, what are you talking about? You know, you're hanging out in the back of the chamber talking with your buddy, you know. You got girls in sports. And a senator would walk in. My friend moved me frantically, and he followed the senator, pull out his chair, and help him sit down. I'm a kid who grew up in the Bronx in Yonkers. I haven't seen this kind of behavior. I say, come back. I say, what's the matter, man? The cat can't sit down by himself. He needs some help. Well, you just saw happen in the Christie thing over here. The level of pettiness. The level of pettiness. We're going to close down the bridge. And then you talk to who the people were talking to each other? Both from high school. High school pals. That's all this is. Get it in your head. It's high school. The same people you hated in high school and college that wanted to be class president and head of the student council are now running our lives. They follow their career path. We're listening to Christie's. Matter of fact, I asked Anthony Frieda, do me a favor, man. I want you to do a sandwich to Christie. You know, maybe you can make like a big George Washington Bridge and really stack it up. How can these people get away with this? It's one after another. So what's happened to America? Why is it going downhill? Gee whiz, can't figure it out. Son of a gun. All of these people that are making decisions, life and death decisions for us. Life and death decisions and robbing us of our dignity and respect. You know, I get a lot of people say, oh, Mr. Slint, you're brave for speaking. I'm not brave for speaking. You know what brave is? Brave is 9/11 first responders and others that go into burning buildings. That's brave. Else's. I don't tell anybody what to believe. The motto taught to me by my dear father, may his soul rest in peace, anytime I'd be battling on, he'd look at me in an Italian and say to me, Papagallo, Baron, stop repeating what everybody else is saying and think for yourself. So what I have to say is only the way I say it. So that's not bravery. That's self-respect and dignity. And when people find it in themselves and have the courage to say, how could you? Luke, I love Luke, the fellow that goes and confronts all these guys. Yeah. And he'll tell you, you're looking at these guys in the eyes, man, and they fold. They fold. We're security. They're little men. It's on a pair of cojones if you put them all together. Maybe a size or more. Again, if you look up to these politicians, you're looking down upon yourself. So, we look at some of the other things that are going on. Anthony asked me to talk about, these wars. I grew up during the Vietnam War. By the way, that's why I went to college. I just couldn't imagine. I wasn't intelligent enough to be opposed to the war. I just couldn't imagine being in a foreign country with a lot of weight on my back. And it's just these rice paddies, guys up there getting shot at, So you go back to the Vietnam War. Why were there the protests in Vietnam? Very simply, the draft. Now everybody has lockjaw. Longest wars in American history going on in Afghanistan. We're gonna get Bin Laden. And the flags waved and people tied yellow ribbons around everything they couldn't move. Made in China flags at that. The last man to me that I knew as a kid growing up that had a chance to show who he was Dwight D. Eisenhower, 5-star general, supreme commander of the Allied forces, 2-term president. Not one of these little chicken hawks. I'm the commander-in-chief. Hey, lead the charge, Jack, or else shut your mouth. Oh, no, I'm the commander-in-chief, and I look at this situation, and how can people believe this crap? Eisenhower, there were no wars, because he knew what war looked like. He entered the Korean War. So Eisenhower makes this little speech as the Korean War ends. Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and not clothed. The world in arms is not spending money alone. It's spending the sweat of our laborers, the genius of our scientists, the hopes of our children. And it goes on. This is Cross of Iron Street. So this is not any way of life at all in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from a cross of iron. So now it's gone from humanity hanging from a cross of iron in the Cold War to the war on terror. Dun, 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 dun. We're going to rob you all your rights. Hey, has anybody ever asked? And again, if you have believed, don't believe whatever happened, but let's suppose it happened the way they say they did. Why did they attack us? I got it. Hey, George, come out here. Yeah, you little jerk. Get over here. They hate us because of our freedom and liberty. And everybody bought it. Hey, it couldn't be because of foreign policy, could it? No, hey! Giuliani said it's not. Don't say that. Little Rudy. Little boys. And the people buy it. Hey, again, I'm speaking from a place where I wrote about it would happen before it happened. In my books, Trends 2000. Pick up. Go to our website, trendsjournal.com. Go to the forecast page. USA Today, December 14th, 2000. 9 months before 9/11. Americans won't be safe at home or abroad. Hey, it couldn't be those drone strikes why they still hate us. No! Hey, man, them are suspected militants. Against anything in the Geneva Convention, killing people that haven't been tried of anything. But hey, everything Hitler did was to the letter of the law. Martin Luther King said that. Couldn't hate us because we invade starving countries. No! Hey, we're the exceptionals. Couldn't hate us because we support dictators. They won't call what's going on in Egypt. You can't make this up. A military coup. And you know why they won't call it a military coup? Maybe they can't spell it. I don't know. But the other reason is, so the military-industrial complex could take our money and give it to them at the tune of $1.5 billion. Hey, but don't bail out Detroit. The country's rotten. And the military-industrial complex, just as Eisenhower warned, has robbed us of the genius of the scientists. You had somebody talking about fracking. This other gentleman talking about the power companies. Don't you think it's the 21st century we could have an alternative energy beyond wind, solar, geothermal, or biofuel? If the genius of the scientists could have made an atom bomb in 4 years? No. Because we got the military-industrial complex and now the cyber-industrial complex at a tune of $90 billion a year that we have to feed. It's a takeover. And not only that takeover, it's the Wall Street takeover. Our September 2008, Trends Journal, Trend Alert. DC heist, Wall Street hijacks Washington. Yeah, you look at the cats, man. The one under Clinton. Little Robert Rubin, head of Goldman Sachs, deregulated the industry, Glass-Steagall Act, allowed the banks to become the criminal operations they are. And then they had the guy under Bush. Henry Paulson, man. Well, he would have been great in a Frankenstein movie, man. He makes up this line one day, they're too big to fail. Don't call what's going on socialism, Marxism, or communism. By definition, from a paisano of mine, Mussolini, who knew a thing or two about it, the merger of state and corporate powers is called fascism. NSA, the militarization of the police force. Who are these jerks listening into us? Who are they? I'll tell you who they are. Booz Allen Hamilton. Perfect name, Booze. And you know who the head of Booze is? A bozo that was the NSA chief under Slick Willie Clinton. Yeah, McDonald. It's a takeover. These little arrogant boys that Luke runs into all the time are telling us how to tie our shoes. Christie's. I'm not a bully. No, you're an arrogant sociopath and sociopath like the rest of them. You couldn't fight your way out of a paper bag. You couldn't run up a flight of stairs. A bully. When Eisenhower made his farewell address, that every speech that everyone, I believe, should listen to, he said the military-industrial complex would cause military spending to be driven not by national security needs, but by a network of weapon marketers, makers, lobbyists, and elected officials. When Eisenhower made that speech in 1960, the US GDP was roughly at about $560 billion. You know what China's was? About $60 billion. Now today, take a look. What are the numbers here? Yeah, the U.S. GDP, it's about $5.6 trillion. Hey, China, $8.5 trillion. We make nothing anymore. They sold us out, NAFTA. Al Gore, and a quick Al Gore story. There's a guy, John J. Hooker, from Tennessee. He ran for governor. His brother was the head of Hospital Corporation of America. I write about it in the Trends Journal. I had met John Connolly 2 weeks before the 92 election. The picture of me, John Connolly, and his wife Nellie with the book depository behind my shoulder, and Hooker put it together. And Hooker also ran for governor. And I go to his apartment first. I flew down to Nashville, then we flew to Dallas. And I stayed overnight. And in Hooker's apartment, there's him with the Kennedys, a buddy, Kenny Bunkport, and there's Hubert Humphrey. This John J. Hooker's been there. So this is, again, 2 weeks before the elections in 92. So I said to Hooker, I said, hey, in Nashville, right? I said, what's Al Gore like? Hooker looks at me, he goes, an arrogant boy. An arrogant boy. We got arrogant boys and girls leading our lives. Where will it take us? And you keep looking around. You have the military-industrial complex, you have the banking industry, you have Congress. Then how could I ever forget the entertainment industry? Look how high, look how wonderful we've... Tracking trends is an understanding of where we were, where we are, how we got here, and where we're going. So let's just take a look at entertainment, just for a quick little moment. Ah, look how we've progressed. We've gone from Ella Fitzgerald to Miley Cyrus. How about that, Tom? That twerk. How about a jerk? We went from Louis Armstrong to Jay-Z. What else have we got there? Hey, I got one, a perfect comparison. Frank Sinatra to Justin Bieber. Oh, how about that? Who else we got over there? Nat King Cole. Snoop Dogg. How about Billie Holiday? Nicki Minaj. Yeah. You know, I know the words to her song. I'm gonna perform it for you. You a hoe, you a hoe, you a hoe. You a hoe, you a hoe, you a hoe. You a hoe, you a hoe, you a hoe. You a hoe, you a hoe, you a stupid hoe. That's where we're going here, man. Morality, it's gone. Not one head on Wall Street roll. Not one. $1 billion fines, multi-billion-dollar fines. But you don't step out of line. They're stopping people now from jaywalking in L.A. Make sure you're walking in lines. That's the other thing. The militarization of the police in America is disgusting. They're breaking out of stock. John the Slime Corzine. No. Oh. No. Jamie Legs Diamond from J.P. Morgan Chase. Lloyd Blankfein. No, no, those were just missteps and misstatements. They're never criminal acts. So, wrapping up, I want to read something to you from the Trends Journal that we're just putting out now. It's called Wake Up Call. And this is the end of the piece. As the year ended, anti-apartheid legend Nelson Mandela passed on. In rejoicing the freedom of his people, Mandela said, "The UN took a strong stand against apartheid, and over the years an international consensus was built, which helped to bring an end to this iniquitous system. But we know too well that our freedom is incomplete without the freedom of the Palestinians." Mandela said Israel should withdraw from all the areas which it won from the Arabs in 1967, and in particular, Israel should withdraw completely from the Golan Heights, from South Lebanon, and from the West Bank. As the year began, pro-apartheid champion Ariel Sharon passed on. In vowing to continue to take Palestinian land to expand Israeli settlements, Sharon told Winston Churchill's grandson, quote, "We will make a pastrami sandwich out of them. We will insert a strip of Jewish settlements in between the Palestinians, and then another strip of Jewish settlements right across the West Bank, so that in 25 years' time, neither the United Nations nor the United States, nobody, will be able to tear it apart. Agree, disagree, fond memories or disgusting ones, both men are dead, and both are just dust. They did what they did to help shape the future, but they didn't do it alone. They followed many that fought and died who preceded them, and their goals and ambitions were fulfilled with the support of like-minded followers. What are you going to do today that will help shape tomorrow? Will you ignore the current events forming future trends, passively watch them unfold, or help create tomorrow? What legacy will you leave? Will it make a difference? Who will care about what you did, what you said you did, but didn't do or could have done? Who will really care about your legacy other than your soul? How will history judge you? History doesn't judge. You are the judge. When you're dead, you're gone. This is a wake-up call." Thank you very much.